Serpens, the Serpent, is a constellation that can be seen in both the northern and southern hemispheres, and it's unique in the sense that it is divided into two separate parts in the sky, the Serpent's head and the Serpent's tail, and these two parts are connected to the constellation known as Ophiuchus. Serpens is also associated with many various myths and legends from different cultures. In Greek mythology, it is often associated with the story of Asclepius, the god of medicine, who is often depicted with a serpent entwined around a staff, which is now the symbol of modern medicine, called the Rod of Asclepius. And in this video, we will explore how to find serpents in the sky, mythologies connected with this constellation, and fascinating celestial objects that can be seen within its borders. Welcome to Learn the Sky. My name is Janine, and I'll be your guide as we explore the night sky one constellation at a time. First, let's get a broad overview of Serpens, the Serpent constellation. It is classified as an ancient constellation, and it dates far back into human history, as far back as the Babylonian times. And there are multiple legends about Serpens, particularly in Greek mythology, but we'll explore some of those later on in the video. The name Serpens is derived from the Greek word meaning serpent, and it was recorded as one of Ptolemy's 48 constellations in the 2nd century. This constellation is unique because it is broken up in the sky, but is still classified as one constellation. So when can you see it? It's best seen in the northern hemisphere during the summertime, which would be winter for the southern hemisphere. And the best way to find serpents is to look for Ophiuchus. And I do that using Hercules because they're both right next to each other in the sky. I can also find Ophiuchus by using Scorpius, which I'll point out here. So Scorpius is down at the bottom of this picture, and Hercules would be right up here. Corona Borealis is also off screen, but nearby, so you can use those points in the sky to help you direct towards Serpens. But the stars of this constellation are faint. They're mostly of 4th and 5th and 6th magnitude, so you really need to seek out dark skies when trying to find this constellation. Now let's take a look at the pattern of Serpens and get practice with identifying it through pictures. Here we have the star map that is related to Serpens, and notice that it is two star maps wrapped into one. So we have Serpens caput, which is the head of the serpent. You can tell it's the head by the triangle part or shape right here in the star pattern. And then it's connected to Ophiuchus. And then this is the back end of the snake, Serpens cauda, and that stands for tail. So you can see this is the harder part of the constellation to find. And as I said earlier, that most of the stars are of 4th, 5th, and 6th magnitude. So this is a difficult constellation to find. And this, looking at this star map is a little bit confusing to me because I really think of both Serpens and Ophiuchus as three constellations in one. I can't see one without looking at the other or noticing the other. So here is the shape of Ophiuchus. It makes this large pentagon shape in the sky. I can identify it by this bright star, but definitely dark skies are needed in order to find this constellation. And you can see the serpent's head is on one side and the tail is on the other. So now let's look at some pictures and we're going to get some practice here. So a few things stand out to me as I look at this photo. I notice that the Milky Way is on the left side and it's brightest right in this area, which tells me that Sagittarius is nearby. It is on this picture, but it's kind of cut off. And I also see Scorpius down here. These are planets, but what we are looking at is Ophiuchus and Serpens. Notice the head right here has that triangle shape, and then the tail goes into the Milky Way galaxy. So that's another way to tell the difference between the two if you happen to have enough, like dark enough skies to be able to see this constellation. When I'm stargazing near areas with lots of light pollution, I can't really see either of these constellations. I just know the general area of where it's at. So some other things to notice, we have the planets right here, and this is where Scorpius is. Up in this region by the head of the serpent, there is Corona Borealis, and also Hercules is up in this region, kind of borders these constellations. So let's keep getting some more practice here. This constellation, the main one right in the center of the photograph, is Scorpius. So Scorpius is one of those constellations that you can use to help you find Ophiuchus and Serpens. And we're only seeing the tail, or a part of the tail of the snake here. So here is this shape right there. That is the fishhook asterism, or Scorpius. We have Sagittarius right here, the archer. This pattern is sometimes called the teapot. I do have videos on both of those asterisms. And then this here is Ophiuchus. And this is a planet right here. So if a planet passes through a constellation, it's on the ecliptic, which is the path of the sun, moon, and stars. So technically, Ophiuchus would be considered a zodiacal constellation. All right, we've got one more photo to help give us some more practice. This is the usual northern summer sky photo that I use constantly because it has a bunch of constellations. So I want you to take your view to the right side of the photo and then try to find Scorpius. You can also try to find Sagittarius. And then from there, move upwards. And then that is the general region of where Ophiuchus is and Serpens. If you can't see it, that's pretty typical of this constellation. It's really difficult to point out. So let's go ahead and show where everything is. You can see Scorpius is in red right here. Okay, and then Sagittarius is down here. Remember, the steam comes out of the teapot, which is what Sagittarius is also referred to as. And then here is Ophiuchus, and he is holding the snake. So we're only really seeing the tail portion and not so much the head of the snake. But notice that if I back up here, notice that that pattern is really difficult to point out in the sky. If there's one that's easier, it's like that pentagon shape or coffin-like shape of Ophiuchus, and then from there you can try to point out the tail. But again, this is one that's very challenging to see. But even though it's difficult to see, it's one that is really worth trying to seek out a dark sky because the celestial objects in this constellation are pretty incredible. So that's what we're going to talk about next. Now we're going to take a look at some of the celestial objects that are located in the Serpent's constellation. When you look at this star map, it doesn't look like there are a ton of objects that sit within the borders of the Serpent constellation. But if we use a different star map, you can see that there is a lot to see here. And we're going to only focus on a few of the celestial objects that are in within the Serpent, but there it's just nearby to a lot of other cool stuff. So I really encourage you to try to find some of these celestial objects if you happen to have a pair of binoculars or a telescope. So we're going to focus on the head of the Serpent and then the tail of the Serpent afterwards. So in the head of the Serpent, there is a galaxy called NGC 5921 and another globular cluster called Messier 5. So Messier 5 is classified as a globular star cluster, and its distance is estimated to be 24,500 light years away. This is about 80 light years across, and globular clusters are in spheroidal in shape. So I have a whole video on the difference between globular clusters and open star clusters. So go see that video if you want to learn more. But this is one that's kind of right at the naked eye limit. So you may be able to see it if you have very dark skies or if you have a pair of binoculars to help you as well. NGC 5921 is a barred spiral galaxy, and that's much further away at 65 million light years away. So this is just such an incredible galaxy to view. Here's a close-up version of it, and I like it because you can clearly see the bar going through the galaxy and then the spiral-shaped arms. Remember with galaxies that the younger stars are typically in the arms of the galaxy, and you have older stars towards the core. Another really cool object that's located in Serpens is something called Hoag's object, and this is a very unique galaxy. It's a ring galaxy, and it's estimated to be 60 million light years away. And if we were to look at where it is located in the night sky, if you have the triangle part of the Serpent's head right here, And then Corona Borealis is right here. It's in this region where Hoag's object is. But this would be difficult to see. This photo was taken with the Hubble Space Telescope. And what's interesting is that there seems to be a disconnect between the core of the galaxy and then the spiral arms. And what's interesting enough is if you look in this space, it looks like there's another ring galaxy further in the distance that we can see through the one ring galaxy. So this is just a fascinating picture to me. What we do know about this galaxy is that there are older stars here and younger stars in the arms of the galaxy. In the tail of the serpent, there are some very interesting and famous objects that lie within the boundaries of this portion of the constellation. The first is NGC 6536. This is a globular star cluster. And then the Eagle Nebula, which has the very famous pillars of creation. So let's get started. NGC 6535 is a globular star cluster. It's estimated to be 22,000 light years away. And this is where it would be located in the constellation. If this is the arm of Ophiuchus, this is the tail of the serpent. It is located kind of in between the tail and arm of each constellation. And then the Eagle Nebula is very famous because it is an open star cluster as well as a glowing emission nebula. But then there are also dark regions within this area as well, which would make it a dark nebula as well. And this is an area of very active star formation, and it's estimated to be 5,700 light years away. And right here, if you look at this area of the Eagle Nebula, it has the Pillars of Creation. This is a very famous picture and photo first taken by the Hubble. It almost looks like a hand reaching up. And this is taken by the James Webb Space Telescope. So you can see this is just such an incredible photo. I can stare at this for ages and just be enthralled by all the detail inside of it. But this is an area that is highly studied for areas of star formation. So inside these areas of gas and dust are little baby stars that are just waiting to be born. And this area will be continued to be studied just because of its interesting shape and stellar formation. Let's examine some of the legends behind Serpens. It is often the stories of the stars that we can connect to in some way, which can help us remember the constellation. Many of the constellations that we see today are ancient in origin, and many are connected to Greek mythology. And in Greek mythology, Serpens represents a giant snake that is held by the healer known as Asclepius, who is represented as the Ophiuchus constellation that is pictured here. And this is not the earliest depiction we see of serpents. It is definitely connected back to Babylonian mythology of the serpent god called Nera, which I have circled here in this picture. And Nera was depicted as a hybrid being with a human head and torso, and then having serpents for legs. Many of us do connect to Asclepius in Greek mythology. He was the son of Apollo, and he was a healer that was said to be able to bring people back from the dead with his healing powers. And in some versions of this tale, he learned to do this from snakes. In another story, Asclepius was raised by Chiron, who taught him the art of healing. In another version of this tale, Asclepius the healer was able to heal and resurrect Hippolytus after he was thrown from his chariot. But this resurrection angered Zeus because he did not want humans to become immortal. He saw this as a threat. So he killed Asclepius with a bolt of lightning and later placed him up in the sky to honor his gifts and deeds. Another story I found is one of Asclepius learning from another snake how to resurrect using special herbs after observing a snake resurrecting another dead snake. And he learned this skill and brought it to the people. And I found many depictions of Ophiuchus and his staff with a serpent wrapped around it. And this is a direct reference to the rod of Asclepius. And this symbol is still used today in health and medical professions. For example, in the star of life. You can see this right here. This is the rod of Asclepius. And this is an ancient symbol of healing. You'll also see it in the World Health Organization logo. And there is actually a medical intervention in which you use a kind of a matchstick size piece of wood to extract like a little worm. And this is called a guinea worm disease. And, you know, this is not for the faint hearted, but this is a disease that a person can get when they drink water that contains water fleas and it has this guinea worm larva. After you ingest this, what ends up happening is the female worm forms this painful blister on the skin. Usually it's like on a lower limb. And what needs to happen is you use a little matchstick to kind of wind it around the worm. It is, I love teaching my students about this because I'm like, look, this is tied to like astronomy and medical interventions. And this procedure is actually described in an ancient Egyptian medical text. So again, there's just, that's kind of taking you on the rabbit trail here of one of the mythologies. And this is something that just really fascinates me is how we still connect the modern day science to ancient science and mythologies. We've come to the end of our video about Serpens the Serpent. So let's review everything we've learned so far. It's best seen during the summertime in the northern hemisphere, which would be the winter months for the southern hemisphere. The best way to find it is to use Scorpius as a focal point in the sky and navigate from there. You can also use the head of Hercules to help you find Rasselhaig, which is the bright star in Ophiuchus. And if you can find Ophiuchus, go from there and look for the serpent that he's holding. In terms of celestial objects, there are so many to see in this area, but I didn't go over all of those in this video, just a handful of the ones that are more visible. So thank you so much for watching this video. Let me know in the comments below, have you seen this constellation? Have you looked at some of the objects that are seated within the boundaries of this constellation? And remember, it takes time, patience, and practice to learn how to stargaze and identify constellations. So take a friend with you or a pet. Be sure to get comfortable. And as always, keep looking up.